What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the past few weeks, we've been looking into the most frequently used sorting algorithms. Today, in this video, we are going to tackle the efficiency or complexity of each one of them. But before doing so, make sure if you have no idea what sorting algorithms are or how to calculate the complexity of a given algorithm, to check the videos linked in the description down below. So, enough talking and let's get started. Our list of sorting algorithms is going to start with MergeSort, a simple yet highly efficient algorithm. MergeSort is frequently seen in introductory texts due to its ease of analysis, but it's rarely used in practice. Let's take another look at the code behind this sorting algorithm. If you have watched our video on how to calculate the time complexity of a code snippet, you can easily deduce that each element inside the array we want to sort is being traversed twice, which leads to a worst-case complexity, or big O of n squared. And that is pretty bad compared to the other algorithms we are going to see. Next are what we call simple sorts, the selection sort and the insertion sort. Both of these algorithms are efficient on a small data chunk, but when it comes to sorting a large number of data, they are pretty bad. Insertion sort is generally faster than selection sort in practice due to fewer comparisons and good performance on almost sorted data, and thus is preferred in practice. But selection sort uses fewer writes, and thus is used when the write performance is a limiting factor. If you recall, the code backing these two algorithms is similar to what you can see in front of you. And same as the MergeSort algorithm we just covered, these two code snippets have a big O of n squared, like that is the worst case you can have. You may not have a time complexity of n squared for all the arrays or lists you are trying to sort. It depends on whether the array you are passing to these algorithms is partially sorted or not, for example, or the size of the array can be another variable to take into consideration. But remember, the big O notation is all about worst-case scenarios, and that is exactly why we are considering our big O here to be O of n squared. If we mentioned insertion sort, we also have to mention shell sort, as it is an improved version of the insertion algorithm. You see, in insertion sort, we were moving elements only one position at a time, and this led to a complexity of O of n squared, as we just saw. Let's break this complexity further. As you already know by now, it can be written as O of n times n, and the first n denotes the number of items in the array. Okay, cool. But the second one actually denotes the greatest distance between two out-of-place elements. And in its worst case, this can refer to the distance between the first and the last element of the array, which is also equal to n. The shell sort algorithm improves on the insertion sort one by trying to minimize this distance as much as possible. So it sorts the elements far away in the array and progressively shrinks the gap between the elements to sort. Now, back to complexity. The big O of the shell sort algorithm, as we just mentioned, heavily depends on the preliminary sorting done, the one that is supposed to shrink the gap. And if this step succeeds, there is no doubt that shell sort will outperform insertion sort. But keep in mind, what we are trying to find here is the worst of the worst that we may encounter. And the worst case here is that this preliminary sorting did very little to nothing to help the actual insertion sort that will come after. And this means that we did pick the worst gap we could. So, we are now stuck with the normal insertion sort algorithm, and therefore the big O of the shell sort algorithm in its worst case is none other than O of n squared time complexity. Now, before moving to the remaining sorting algorithms for today, I want to mention that the four algorithms we discussed until now, the MergeSort, selection sort, insertion sort, and shell sort, are all in-place sorting algorithms, and do not require additional memory to sort the array given to them. Therefore, the additional space complexity required by these algorithms is constant and represented as O of 1. Next on the list is the famous MergeSort algorithm. Let's have a look together at the code snippet of MergeSort covered in a previous video to remember what it looks like. You can clearly see from the MergeSort method that this algorithm can be divided into three steps and that these steps are being repeated recursively on every subarray we pass to them. First, we are dividing the array or subarray into two halves by fetching the index of the middle element. Two, we are calling the MergeSort method on each half. Three, we proceed by merging the two sorted halves. Now, the first step is actually pretty straightforward. All we are doing is calculating the index of the middle element, and this on its own has a constant complexity of O of 1. The second step is calling MergeSort twice on each half. And because what we are actually trying to find is the complexity of the MergeSort method, what we are going to do is write the complexity here as a function. So each call should take around t of n over 2, because the number of elements is half the initial number we started off with, right? And because it is called twice, the total time taken by step 2 should be around 2 times t of n over 2. The third and final step is merging the two sorted halves. And to merge these halves, we will have to go through every single element contained in each of the arrays or subarrays, which is the total number of elements in our initial array, which happens in its worst case to be n, the initial number of elements in the array. Therefore, the complexity of the third step is going to be O of n. Now, let's sum the complexities of all three steps to get the complexity of the merge sort method given n elements. So, t of n will be equal to O of 1 plus 2 times t of n over 2 plus O of n. O of 1 can be disregarded at this stage, and O of n can be written as a linear function of n, let's say c times n. Okay, now all we have to do is find t of n. And to do that, we have to replace this t of n over 2 with something else. Let's go ahead and try to find the value of t of n over 2 using the t of n we just calculated by replacing n with n over 2. If we do that, as you can see, we will have a t of n over 2 equals 2t of n over 4 plus 2n. Let's replace that in the t of n equation. We will obtain t of n equals 4t of n over 4 plus 2n. Okay, now we have to find t of n over 4. Let's do the same thing we just did to find t of n over 2 and place the result we are going to find in this new expression of t of n. We will have a t of n over 4 that equals 2 times t of n over 8 plus n over 4, and a newly calculated t of n that equals 8 times t of n over 8 plus 3n. Okay, we are not going to calculate t of n over 8, if that's what you were thinking, but I want you to take a closer look at the following equations we just calculated. Can you see a certain pattern? Every time we divide n by 2, the purple numbers here are multiplied by 2, and an n is added to the blue ones right there. We started off with 2 times t of n over 2 plus n, then went to 4 times t of n over 4 plus 2n, and then jumped to 8 times t of n over 8 plus 3n. You can also notice something else. The numbers 4 and 8 can be written using the coefficient on n. What I mean by that is 4 is equal to 2 to the power 2, and 8 to 2 to the power 3. And 2 and 3 are respectively the coefficients of n for their respective functions. And this coefficient is what is changing. It is our variable in this case. Let's name this coefficient k, and take another look at our t of n. T of n is now equal to 2 to the power k times t of n over 2 to the power k plus kn. Now let's take a break from equations and remember how merge sort actually works. Merge sort is going to divide our array into two, and it will keep dividing it and passing the subarrays to the merge sort method until the subarray it is passing has only one single element. And also remember that this t of n over 2 to the power k was written to show the complexity of this step. So this n over 2 to the power k is going to start off as n over 2. But as we divide our array, it will keep shrinking until it becomes one single element. And this is represented by the following equality, where n over 2 to the power k is equal to 1. Hence, t of n over 2 to the power k can be simplified to t of 1, and therefore can be eliminated from the equation. Additionally, as we saw in our complexity video, the equation we just came up with can be simplified to be written as log base 2 of n equals k. So by using this result and making the appropriate replacements, as you can see, we can conclude that t of n is equal to n plus n log base 2 of n. Now, as we previously mentioned, big O denotes the worst case scenario, and given the following equation, we can finally deduce that the big O of the merge sort algorithm is O of n log base 2 of n. I know the math stuff can be a bit painful, but trust me, there is no better way to understand and calculate these complexities without involving a little bit of mathematics. Well, actually, let's go ahead and try to find the complexity behind the QuickSort algorithm by just analyzing the logic behind it. No math involved. The first step in the QuickSort algorithm is the pivot calculation. In the code we previously wrote, we considered the pivot to be the middle element. So, if we take this array as an example, in our first iteration, the pivot should be the element 5. And similarly to MergeSort, we will keep dividing these subarrays into two, until the last subarray we get contains a single element. So the number of partitioning we did can be written as follows. We started with n elements, then divided them by 2, and kept dividing the resulting number by 2 until we reached one or a single element. In this example, we had to divide n 3 times by 2 in order to reach 1. Or in other terms, we had to partition our array 3 times in order to reach the single element arrays. Let k be the number of partitions we need to do and replace this in our equation. Notice that this equation is exactly the same one we had for the merge sort algorithm, and from it we can conclude that the number of partitioning required, or k, is none other than log base 2 of n. However, while partitioning these subarrays, we will need to traverse every element stored inside these arrays, and this traversal depends on the number of elements stored inside the array, hence requires an O of n time complexity. So, the total complexity, or big O of the QuickSort algorithm, is going to be O of n times O of log base 2 of n, which is O of n log base 2 of n. But wait, that is not the end of it, because you see, this result was tied to one particular variable, and it is how we chose to calculate our pivot. In our code, what we did is divide this pivot by 2 as we go. But what if we chose instead to always pick the first element or the last element of the array as our pivot? In that case, the partitioning on the same example we just had will look something like this. And the number of partitioning required, or k in this case, is going to be, you guessed it, in order of n and not log n, which leads to a worst case complexity of O of n squared. That is why actually you should always select the middle element or a random element in your array as your pivot. Now, concerning space complexities, the merge sort algorithm is not an in-place algorithm and uses additional memory to perform the sorting. We are creating an additional temporary array to hold the items we need. Therefore, the additional space complexity required is the order of O of n. However, QuickSort does not need any array and is an in-place sorting algorithm. Yet, if you search about its space complexity, all the references will tell you that QuickSort has a space complexity of O of log n. Where does it come from? Well, we just saw that log n denotes the number of partitioning we need, and every partition implies a new call to our QuickSort method, and these calls are recursive calls. What does that mean? Well, it means that they take up space in the stack memory, and this space is reserved until the whole sorting is complete, hence the O of log n complexity. Okay, we got that. But wait, doesn't merge sort also have recursive calls? Why doesn't it also have a logarithmic function as a space complexity? To be honest, it has, but it is written as O of log n plus O of n. And because O of n has a higher order, we take it as the space complexity of merge sort. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.